We're driven by the search for better. But when it comes to hiring, the best way to search for a candidate isn't to search at all. Don't search, match with Indeed. Indeed is your matching and hiring platform with over 350 million global monthly visitors, according to Indeed data, and a matching engine that helps you find quality candidates fast. Ditch the busy work. Use Indeed for scheduling, screening, and messaging so you can connect with candidates faster. Leveraging over 140 million qualifications and preferences every day, Indeed's matching engine is constantly learning from your preferences. So the more you use Indeed, the better it gets. Join more than 3.5 million businesses worldwide that use Indeed to hire great talent fast. And listeners of this show will get a $75 sponsored job credit to get your jobs more visibility at Indeed.com/Blue Wire. Just go to Indeed.com/Blue Wire right now and support our show by saying that you heard about Indeed on this podcast. That's Indeed.com/Blue Wire. Terms and conditions apply. Need to hire? You need Indeed.
And welcome back to another episode of the California Golden Bearcast, a part of the Blue Wire Podcast Network. We're here. It's Monday night. We've had the 24-hour rule in place, enjoying this absolutely stellar win against Arizona, where we beat our longest-standing Pac-12 opponent losing streak. And it was also the longest losing streak in the matchup history between Arizona and the Bears. So, all in all, a great day on Saturday. So much fun. I'm a little tired, which is why I'm still a little bit down right now. But, man, once we start talking about this game, I'm gonna be hyped. But I'm Rob, of course, alongside me, as always, is co-host Andy. Andy, how are you feeling?
Wilcox is the ender, the first of his name, second of his name. Ender of streaks. That's amazing. He has literally ended every single streak that we've had, I feel like. Oregon, SC, Arizona. Am I missing any?
I think the anecdotal one is he ended our like top 10 like ranked opponent losing streak.
Yes.
When he beat Washington State a few years back. So, yeah, there's a few that he's broken.
Incredible. Yeah, I mean, it's been joyous. It was fun after the game. It was fun reading the Sunday Avi article. It was fun reading Nick's article. Like, Dare to Dream, I think, was one of the things that Nick said at the end.
Nick was a lot more optimistic this week than he was in weeks past.
Yeah, there was something there that I remember my friends distinctly saying at the Notre Dame game, that when you get that little feeling of hope with Cal, that's when they really hurt you. So I think it was great. It was awesome. I mean, it was just so, that the vibes were so good Saturday. I just been saying this to anyone that has attended. I've had, let's see, 3 game days now that we're at Memorial, and they've all been different. I think the first one was me doing yoga and going right to the stadium. The second one was me and my buddy going into the stands a little bit late, but like going around campus was really fun. And then this one was just so much fun going to the CGB right for California tailgate, and then making a pit stop back at the old fraternity house, and then making my way to the stadium just in time for the game to start. But it was just, the vibes were good. I swear there was more people there. I know I tweeted it a couple times under the Right for California Live account, but I would have bet money that there were more people that were at that game than that had been at any game so far. And I know that paid attendance is different because you have season ticket holders, so it's really hard to get a good read on it, because Cal announced basically the same amount, 38,000. But I really did feel like there were sections that were more filled in, and we were treated to a crazy game. I mean, the first half, I kind of like, it took a while to really process what was going on and just how good Arizona's offense was. I just felt like they were dynamic in every aspect of the word. And it was like, someone tweeted me, was like, this is like when you, this is like seeing the progressive part of football and then realizing that you're still running an offense that was like at its peak in the late 2009, 2010s. And I was like, I don't disagree. I didn't disagree whatsoever. I was like, this the way they were carving up the Cal defense was nothing short of just super impressive. And Jaydn Delora looked unbelievable. Their receivers looked unbelievable. I didn't think there was a, I knew that we were going to make some good adjustments. And honestly though, like if you actually looked at that objectively, 21-24, am I right in that? That was halftime?
Or was it? Yeah.
And yeah. I think like if we that went as good to our, that went to our script. And I know that's going to sound insane. You're going to be like, no, it didn't. And I'm going to be like, yeah, you're right. It didn't. But I think it went more towards our script in the sense of, if you were going to tell me as made up, you know, fake Wilcox over here, that I had to bet on one side of my team figuring it out, I'd rather bet on my defense than have to bet on my offense. And with Arizona, they would rather bet on their offense rather than bet on their defense. And so I felt like we ended up in a position where all we really needed was our offense to basically continue to be as effective as it had been, and our defense just to regress to who they actually were. And so that's why I sort of felt pretty optimistic, especially just seeing the way we were moving the ball and rushing the ball and the line and the protection, and all of a sudden Plummer was getting comfortable in the pocket, which is like for the first time all season. Oof, man. Okay, I'll stop there. I did want to check in. How was your game day vibe?
I mean, you and I pretty much had the same experience. I think my thing to you when you said you felt like there was more, I was like, I still think Davis might have had more people. But definitely, this is the type of game where the crowd's a lot more into it, right? The average fan that's there, you know, I'd be hard-pressed not to say, like, look, the modern football game is geared towards offense, and when you're scoring a lot more, you're putting a lot more butts in seats and a lot more fan, just casual fans that aren't, you know, really dissecting the game of football and the momentum shifts and the adjustments and so on. They're just there to watch the big plays. They're there to do the holy crap, what did I just watch? Those types of moments. And this game, as a Cal fan, gave you all that. Hell, even as an Arizona fan, it gave you a lot of that too, with some of those insane catches by their wide receivers.
Yeah.
So, like, this was like that type of perfect game that you had a bunch of people who came back despite the team, you know, faltering at Notre Dame, and then you gave him a show like this, and this is exactly what you want to be able to continue that momentum in terms of fan attendance.
Here's my thing. I think that the Notre Dame game for the casual fan was an impressive loss, and so I felt like it kept excitement high, even if we had.
You think so?
I do. Casual fan we're talking about here. I really do think, I mean, because I heard from a lot of people that were saying, and, you know, a couple of folks mentioned this. I think one of the writers mentioned this in the interview with Wilcox in the middle of the week. And they were like, yeah, like the feedback from our fans was like, you know, they were pretty excited. And then they asked, like, you know, is it good to be proud of the fact that they were excited that Cal was close to Notre Dame? And, of course, Wilcox was like, no, we expect to win that game. Like, we don't just go there hoping to play a close game. We went in there playing to win the game. Yeah. But that's what I mean, is like there is an audience that looks at that Notre Dame game and is like, yeah, Cal went all the way out to South Bend and was in within a touchdown, like one score game with Notre Dame the whole time. And they're not like super in the know, whether it's like, oh yeah, like Notre Dame lost their starting quarterback and all those things. It's just a little bit more like, hey, like this is Cal Bears football, and like I kind of check in and out of it, but like that looks like a good result. Like I should go check this game out at Memorial.
Well, my devil's advocate with that would be that person, that type of fan, probably isn't the guy that's checking out Memorial the following week.
What?
They're like, oh, it was a good game. And then they're like, oh, there's a music festival happening. I'll just go to that.
No, no.
Like, that's what it feels. That's the kind of person I feel like you're describing.
No, you got to – no, man. The casual fan, we have to acknowledge the almighty being that is the casual fan – that you and I will never be able to speak from that perspective. But I really, there wasn't much competing against it. Yeah, there was the Portola Music Festival, but like that was at a small, pretty small venue. There wasn't a lot competing against it on a damn beautiful day in the Bay on a Saturday. And I just felt it. Like I felt like there was this palpable energy that was a little bit different about the program than we had in years past. It was still more enthusiastic than... We've come back from losses on the road, like TCU, and been like, it was kind of a lull. And this felt like there was good energy from the get-go. And Arizona didn't show up at all. Like their fans, what was there, 60 of them? I mean, that was crazy. I remember Arizona used to come and pack the stands, and we would hear that stupid USA chant, or the UA chant, or whatever it is, U of A, and then we would make fun of them by doing a USA chant. Whatever it is, it was dumb, and... none of them showed up anyways. So they're definitely still recovering their brand.
But well, yeah, that I think a 1-11 season will do that for you.
It will. It certainly did for us.
Yeah.
And we've been chasing that ever since.
Yeah.
But yeah, I just felt the energy was great. And you know.
Well, yeah,
I mean, you think Davis, I don't know. I'll battle you on that one. I'd say the eye test for me, because we're never gonna know. Because this paid attendance is based, like, season ticket holders.
Yeah, we'll never know.
We'll never know. But my eye test said more people. If Cal wins, if Cal beats Colorado and comes back 4-2 against a 5-1 Washington, I'm expecting that game to, like, creep north of 45 to 50K.
Yeah, I mean, that game's going to be a night game, too. If we come, if we're going to that UW game, well, we're getting ahead of ourselves. But if we're going into that UW game 5-1, that's a night game.
Well, 5-1, I said 4-2. So it's like 5-1, you're 5-1. Dude, you start getting into the territory of like if Washington hasn't lost. So let's say Washington hasn't lost yet. And Cal's 5-1 and their only loss is to Notre Dame.
You're getting into the territory of ESPN Game Day.
You're in the ballpark. All right, so far ahead of ourselves. My bad. My bad, y'all. Dare to dream. It's all Nick's fault. He told me to dream. I'm dreaming all day.
let's circle back. Let's talk about this game first, all right? And we got to talk about this game in a variety of ways. So the first thing, I'm just going to run everyone through the stats here, right? Just so you have some reference points to work with. So Cal playing Arizona has a 6-game losing streak against Arizona heading into this game since 2009. Of course, we don't play them every year, so you know it's not a yearly game thing. So 6 games since 2009. The Bears pull out the win 49-31. This game pretty much wrapped up in the third quarter, I would say. That was my feeling. And I'll ask Andy about his thoughts later, and we'll go through some of our feelings as we entered into the fourth quarter. But it was just, who would have thought this game would be a shootout, right? But at the same time, if you've watched Arizona Cal games in the past, this is not far from the narrative of what happens when these two teams play. It's just anything and everything is on the table of happening. And that's exactly what we got. We did not expect our offense to come out firing like this and dominating the line of scrimmage, but they did. And I mean, we got to talk about Jaydn Ott at the top, right? 19 carries, 274 yards, gained 0 yards, lost 3 touchdowns, a long of 73, followed up with a long of 72, and an average of 14.4 per carry to Carlos Brooks, with 10 behind him with 33 and a touchdown with a long of 8, Jack Plummer, 18 of 28, no interceptions, 3 touchdowns, 245 yards, and a long of 37, not sacked a single time in this game. In terms of receiving, Jeremiah Hunter, 5 catches, 82 yards, 26 yards after the catch, 1 touchdown with a long of 37. J. Michael Sturdivant, 3 catches. Elijah Maharo, 3 catches. Monroe Young, 3 catches. Kelechi Latu, 2 catches. Ott, 2 catches. And Maven Anderson, Tommy Christakos with no catches, but they were both targeted in the game. Jamison Sheehan, of course, with punting, has been an outstanding weapon for us for this year. Punted 4 times, twice inside the 20. Has been absolutely stellar for flipping the field for us. In terms of the team's offense, Cal total net rushing yards, 354, Arizona 135. Total offensive yards, Cal 599, Arizona 536. They did most of their damage through the air. They had 401 yards through the air. And first downs, Cal 27, Arizona 31. Cal didn't need as many first downs because they were just scoring before they needed first downs. In terms of the defense, Craig Woodson, 7 total tackles, 2 tackles for loss. Daniel Scott, 7 total tackles and 1 interception. Jackson Sherman, of course, did his thing with 4 tackles, just solid line. Ryan Puskas, who got his first start of his Cal career with 4 tackles, 1 sack, and 1 tackle for loss. Ricky Correa with also a half tackle for loss. Ray Woody with a half tackle for loss. Jeremiah Earby with a half tackle for loss. And Oren Patu with another good line for his, you know, budging career or blossoming career here, 1 sack and 1 tackle for loss and 1 forced fumble. Now, from this game, we had quite a few notes here, right? Elijah Maharo, TJ Session, and Siope Vatikani, all 3 of them made their first career start. Jaydn Ott rushed for 274 yards, the third highest single game total in Cal history. Jaydn Ott's 73-yard touchdown is Cal's longest since Marcel Dancy had a 76-scoring run against Stanford last year. It's also the longest run by Cal freshman since Kalfani Muhammad had a 73-yarder against Washington in 2013. DeCarlos Brooks's 3-yard touchdown run in the second quarter was the first touchdown of his career. Jeremiah Hunter had a career-high yards receiving yards of 82, and the 49 points is the most the Bears have scored in a single game since also scoring 49 in a 49-7 win against Oregon State back in 2018. Off of this game, Jaydn Ott also winning a plethora of awards this week. He won Player of the Week in the conference. He won... give me 1 second here. He was also, he had the highest run grade on PFF with 99.1, with the highest being 99.9. I believe he is second all time in terms of run grades in PFF history.
That's insane.
Ott currently leads the Pac-12 in rushing yards at 463. He's also 10th in the country or 11th in the country in rushing yards total, but his yards per carry is the highest in the country. I believe the difference between him and the number one rusher in the country is about 30 touches. So not far off. But back to Ott, leads the Pac-12 in rushing yards per game, yards per carry, and is tied for first in rushing touchdowns. So that's that with him. Ben Coleman also got an accolade this week. He was the offensive lineman of the week in the conference after, he had an amazing game too. The entire offensive line did, but kudos to those guys getting those awards this week. Andy, the game, what did you think?
What did I think about this game? I think that... for once, it's nice to have, sometimes when you would like check the Pac-12 scores and you look at the stat lines and like you'd see this random running back from Arizona, like Eno Benjamin, that would just run for like 250 yards. And you're like, what?
Arizona State.
Happening. Sorry, Arizona State. And it's nice to have that happen to us.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's really nice. I think that this game is the redemption game. It's redemption for you.
Mm-hmm.
It was redemption for Jesse. It was redemption for you again. And it was redemption for Christopher H. It was so incredible to see the way that the offense just looked night and day different. And the O-line, everything started with the O-line. The, you know, mixing in TJ Sessions, Vodakani, Ben Coleman winning player of the week, offensive line player of the week, is insanity because he was one of the culprits in the Notre Dame game. So, not to call him out in a negative way, sorry, Ben, but just that the week-over-week improvement from the line was just awesome. And Arizona really didn't have an answer for what we were doing. We mixed in the tight ends more, which you will hear me ask Jack Plummer about in the post game. And I, you know, he just said it was game flow. And it's just such a fascinating thing to see, okay, when you get time, when you have productivity running the ball, all of those things that we kind of asked for, hell, we even ran two running back sets. And I swear I was on this podcast being like, I was watching the Packers game. I was like wondering why we don't do more two running back sets. So it's like, it's incredible to have all of that in one game. And you got to be careful not getting too high here. But I mean, Jaydn is so fun to watch. He's got such good breakaway speed. But that's the thing is, like, those runs are electric, exciting. He's ridiculous. But it's almost like the most impressive runs he had were like the 3 and 4 yard ones that, I mean, there was a big play. It was like third down. We were inside Arizona territory on an important drive. We hand the ball off and he gets two defenders are already in the backfield with Jaydn Ott being handed the ball. And he just like puts them both on skates and gets 4 yards. And that was a huge moment. And that's the type of, those are the type of plays that I really think make a big difference. I saw someone that was like, yeah, I watched the highlight reel and it looked like, you know, when Jaydn was running, you know, he didn't get touched until he was like 8 yards down the field. And I was like, dude, watch the full game, because you're not going to see how he runs, how he leverage. Like, he really has great vision. He, you know, isn't afraid to kind of wait for a hole to open. So many young guys with speed just sprint into the hole when it's there and it closes and like you're like, okay, cool.
Yeah, it's either that or they try to go outside, right?
Or bounce it out. Exactly, bounce it outside. He has such good vision, such good patience beyond his years, that there's a lot more to this running back than just simply speed. And that's why he's starting as a freshman. We forget, like, Javid with his 300-yard game, I'm pretty sure that happened in like junior year.
2008, and so his sophomore year. End of his sophomore year, too. And that was like the second to last game.
Marshawn was on like kick returns his freshman year and like got in a little bit into the offense, but he didn't really break out till his sophomore year when he moved over to number 10. So to do this as a true freshman is ridiculous, absolutely ridiculous. And to do that against, you know, your Pac-12 opener, whew. Man,
I mean, we talked about Ott, but we got to start with the guys in front of him, right? Like, Ott talked about how he was going to take him and Plummer were going to take the O-line guys out to dinner because they owed him so much. Like, the shift happened pretty drastically. We had Coleman at left guard or left tackle. Vodakani starts at left guard. Driscoll actually starts at center, and they shift Cindric off center to right guard, and then they start TJ Sessions at right tackle. Spencer Lavelle was a game time scratch, so he wasn't able to go, so they went with this line. Trace actually texted me like right before the game started. He's like, you seeing that Lavelle's out and like in this line that they're practicing with? I was like, yeah, this is gonna be a make or break line. Like, it's gonna be trial by fire, just because they've been running with the same O-line and the same group for the last 3 weeks. And now you're forced to switch it up. And if it works, it's going to be pretty great because you're probably adding more athleticism to the line. But if it doesn't work because some of these guys haven't played with each other before, or it's their first time playing as a starter ever, or hell, like Vodakani, like it's his first start. And he's a true freshman too, by the way. So, like, at least Jaydn came in the spring and he's had the playbook for, you know, more than half of the calendar year. Vodakani came in towards the end of the summer. So, like, and O-line is probably one of the hardest positions to learn the technique for, to be able to play at the level of a Power 5 conference. So, I kudos to whoever made that call. Like we didn't really get an answer from Wilcox about that. I wish we kind of did in what went into that decision. But that line, I think you and I both agree, this is the line against Washington State. You can't change that line after the performance they just put up on Saturday.
Mm-hmm. Agreed.
Yeah.
Yeah. Why would you? Why would you? Yeah, I mean, the decision to move Cindric out from center was pretty progressive in my eyes.
Yeah, and absolutely.
It just paid off wonderfully. And it's now that we've seen what this offense can do at its peak, it's about like, okay, can you continue that? And how does it change as you're facing different defensive fronts and different defensive schemes? But agreed. O-line, that play, was it Vatakani that was like literally grabbing Jaydn and just like pulling him when Jaydn was facing the wrong direction and just keeping his legs churning?
Yep.
And then all of a sudden he ended up in the end zone. I mean, that play was ridiculous. I was like, first of all, Jaydn Ott, like, just textbook. Never let your legs stop churning.
Yep.
And then for your O lineman to grab you and point you the right direction. It was so cool. So, I mean, that set everything up. The offense just looked totally different. We've had these moments with, whether it be Bo Baldwin or Bill Musgrave, really, we've had moments where with both of them, we've seen the potential of the offense. The real negative is that we just don't see it consistently. But I think what is the unsung performance of the game was Plummer. Plummer throws such a good fade. I mean, Jared Goff level fade. And he puts that ball high in the air too. That pass, like, that was awesome. It was just such a well thrown pass on that touchdown. And he was making like very good plays. Outside of the first quarter, he made a lot of really good, strong throws. I think he had a very quiet 250 and three touchdowns.
Oh, yeah.
And absolutely. That little play they drew up for Latu at fourth down, that was awesome. Kelecki getting into the end zone. I think that was his first touchdown, maybe, of his Cal career.
Might be second.
Second, yeah, because it would have been in the notes, right?
Yeah, yeah, that's probably second.
Someone called out, like, his brother had a good game. He had a good game. So that was pretty cool for him, those two getting the shout-out. But, yeah, we just saw a totally different-looking team. That was kind of what we wanted to see against UNLV.
Yeah, I think the major like plot thread on the offense is, at least for me, like, this doesn't seem like a fluke offensive game. Like, it's not a lot of broken plays, and we just happen to win off of like just, you know, throwing our heads back and laughing because of the insanity which ensued. Like, these were hard won plays where the guys soundly beat the one-on-one matchup on the other side of the line, and they just executed to perfection. And it's clear that this is the type of game that they needed, right? Where, okay, like, our offense can put up these types of points. Like, no one looked shocked on the offense that they were doing this. Like, everyone was like, yeah, we just haven't been able to do it, but we're doing it now. And I think that the threat of Jaydn Ott totally changes the complexion of this offense. That now, I mean, look, if Ott doesn't come out like this, right? If you're the defensive coordinator on the other side, like, what's the first thing you're telling your guys? I would probably say it's just, we're gonna pass rush like crazy because they don't have a run game that's strong enough to hold, and then we're gonna force Plummer to throw under pressure, and that's how we're gonna beat them. But now, the first name that you're going to see on the board for defensive coordinators is Jaydn Ott. And I loved the answer that Justin Wilcox gave when I asked him about, like, the pass pro. And because he kind of gave it from his own defensive coordinator experience without really saying it was from his own experience. He was saying how, like, third and multiple, like, different looks, you can do so many different things. You're not zoned in on one thing anymore. You're not only worried about their pass now on third and eight. Like when it's third and three, you're worried about are they going to run or are they going to pass? What other things could they do? And it changes the way you call the game. And it sounded like he was talking from experience, which why wouldn't he be? Because he was a defense coordinator in Power 5 football for so long. So that just that added dimension to this offense just totally changes the game now. Like the defense that we're going to play against Washington State, they're probably the scout team guy who has to play Ott is going to get a lot of work in this week because that's probably what they're zoning in on, right? And I was talking to Peter about this week in the Discord. I was just like, dude, I would not be surprised if we came out of the gate just firing deep balls. Because they're going to be so zeroed in on the run game, right? You run a play action or two in the first drive, and you might get a deep shot because the safety might come down thinking it's a handoff to Ott.
Mm. Yeah.
Like, that's how much of a threat he is. The dude put up 200 yards on a Power 5 opponent last week. Yeah. Like, how are you not going to zero in on him?
I love that. Yeah. And I think ultimately, I think the other running backs played well too.
Yeah.
And like Damian looked really good. We were like, where's Damian Moore? And then he came in and he did what Damian Moore does. He like made the right cuts and got in. He just doesn't have that breakaway speed, but he's a damn good running back with really good vision and he has the ability of breaking tackles.
Yeah.
And then DeCarlos has looked strong for 2 weeks as well. So I think that like we kind of have multiple options there and are building, like we're building towards that if we don't have it right now. And that just is going to give the offense so much flexibility. And if just, I mean, I don't know why I keep watching Packers games, but you just keep watching, you know, Aaron Jones and AJ Dillon kind of do their thing and see how it impacts defenses. And really, if you can get those guys out blocking for each other, just like what it frees up that offense to do. And then ultimately what it frees up the quarterback to do with the football. There's a lot of reasons to be excited for that. And I think Washington State will be a pretty good test to see like, hey, can we do this again? Can we do it on the road? And yeah, I mean, I think like on the road and, you know, second Pac-12 game, we're going to learn a lot. And then we'll probably have a game that ends up not meaning as much in Colorado. And, you know, going into a bye week. I mean, it's just so realistic. I mean, you know, for us, I think it's like, hey, like, how do you go from here? You know, I think expectations have to be, no matter what, you're 4-2.
Yeah, I mean, you go into every week expecting to win, right? That's like Will Clox's thing. I just going off of what you were talking about, like the running backs and the other guys, like, you know, there was a lot of people upset that they didn't put in Jaydn Ott like towards the end of the fourth, you know, when we needed a drive sustained, but instead we go 3-and-out, and there were some other running backs playing. I think that was a combination of two things. Like, I just want to give my 2 cents on it. I think it was a combination of this guy has taken like 15 touches and gone for over 200 yards. He could use a break because he's a true freshman. But also, I think the staff knows that this is a long season, right? We're only 4 games into a 12-game season. The other running backs need snaps. You got to be prepared in any shape or form. And if this is the moment where you're up by two scores and you're able to get these guys some meaningful running play snaps in game, like, you got to do it. And just be prepared. I mean, I don't think anyone's going to get injured with the way like we'd run our running backs right now and the way that Jaden's running, but I mean, it's football. You know, a hamstring pull during practice could mean that one of these other guys have to play, and you don't want to be throwing a guy in there even as the second or third running back who's never actually played in a game before.
Yeah.
That's why it was awesome to see guys like Ashton Shreddick and Ashton Hayes get even a couple of snaps towards the end of the game in garbage time. Because those guys are some of those guys are development guys, right? They'll play, but it's just not this year. But in the off chance those guys need to play in games towards the end of the season, at least they're not being thrust out, you know, against SC or – yeah, against SC in LA, like for their first ever snap of the season. So I think Wilcox talked about that too, right? Like, we want to be in games where we're ahead and have those garbage time minutes where we can get some of these guys playing time because it's so valuable to be able to get real live game snaps in. And a lot of, for some of those guys that are walk-ons too, like just to be able to thank them for all that they do in practice and being a part of the team without actually getting to see the field, but you give them some of those opportunities. And I think this was, you hope that that might've been the FCS game, but either way, you got a game in for them to do that.
Yeah, I think that this was a, it just sets a different course for the season right now. And even though we're kind of executing against what we said would happen, and you know, we've said from day one that Cal has to win the early season. Cal has to kind of come out of this stretch 4-2 at the very worst, I think is what we said.
Yeah.
Anything short of 4-2.
Yeah, I mean, what we were talking about, what Nam talks about when we talk to him is like, and Nick as well, it's like how we win matters just as much as winning.
Yes.
And the way we won this game changes the view on the program. If this is the turning point, right? If this is where like the lights turned on, we've turned the page, we're starting a new chapter, whatever cliche you want to use. If this is that moment for this offense, then this absolutely totally changes the complexion of how we look at games down the line. Because we haven't even started talking about the defense, right? But the defense gave up 24 points in the first half and then decided to lock down in the second. 0 points up until that last touchdown. By that point, we were already up. So,
big time. Up 18.
Yeah, up big time. So, like, yeah, if that's if we know the defense is going to adjust, we know the defense is clicking, and if this is where the offense finally turns into the offense we all think it is, and whatever me and Jesse have been watching for the last month at practice, then, like, how can you not get excited, right? How can you not get excited for the rest of the season and how it plays out? Like, I love that no one's really counting us in yet, and that's kind of where these guys are at, is they're like, you know. And I guess we kind of talk about this because it fits right in, but I got roasted by the Arizona fan base this past weekend. Like, absolutely roasted because I called a 45-28 victory for Cal, right? Even though predictions are a joke, right? Like, if I'm getting all my predictions right, I told you this in the press box, but I was like, if I'm getting all my predictions right, I'm in Vegas. I'm not in the press box.
You should be in Vegas after 45-28. Go to Vegas right now. Yes, you got roasted by Arizona and their fans who took a prediction far too serious, like far too personally, and then proceeded to get upset with Christopher H. for saying that Delora might throw interceptions. It's like, everyone's just so angry these days.
I think the most hilarious part, I know you went in and read the comments after the game, but like, it's just hilarious how everyone's like, maybe we were a little bit too mean.
Yes.
Like after the game.
Like, whoops. I don't know. It's so funny. It's like the article is clearly, it's like not like you went out to Desert Swarm and were like, hey, can I come on and do a Q&A with you guys so that I can roast your team? It's like they reached out to you, asked you as an expert insider what your thoughts were, and decided that to take offense against that. But yeah, it was pretty funny. That was absolutely hilarious. And I do want to say one thing. I think that the other big thing here too, not to move away from this, but was what Jesse talked about on our season preview pod. And Jesse was the one that said that the rule of 21 was going to go away. And he said that the offense was going to be able to score to get this team back into football games when they were down. And after the first four games, I was like, yo, Jesse, I don't know if that's correct. And he was spot on. And this game changed that. This game ended ended many great traditions. And you know what? Malort can stay away. Malort was part of the problem. Goodness, to think we were drinking that terrible, terrible liquor for no reason.
Malort was. It got us through last season.
Nope, it was the problem. It was the problem. It wasn't the solution. It was holding us back, Rob. It was holding us back this whole time. This whole time. But, yeah, shout out to Jesse. He deserves that.
Yeah.
That was a big win for his redemption arc as well. But just like all of these different mini storylines of redemption arcs, there's so many of them. I mean, you could even look at like Musgrave Zone redemption arc storyline and be like, there's one there. Angus McClure. Like, there's a lot. And we haven't even brought up just some of the defensive wins and plays and Isaiah Young's pick as he came in. Like, Lou came off the field. Hope Lou's all right. But it was a fun day in Berkeley. And I hope we have another one of those. I hope it's against Oregon. That would feel just delight. That would be delightful.
So I wrote down a mini timeline, right? Like quarter three or third quarter, 4:59 left. Ott scores the second touchdown where he's like running backwards. And that's the moment where you looked at me and you said something along the lines of, I think you got it right. I think we might score 40 today. And then quarter three with 2:47 left, Oren gets the sack strip. And that's where, personally, that's where I thought the game was over. And that's where we can talk about, that's a perfect place to pivot the defense. Mm-hmm. But the last point was in quarter four, 14:53 left, when Plummer throws that touchdown to Hunter and we make it 42-24. I distinctly remember I leaned back in my chair just to revel in this moment because that was the moment I knew that I was going to be able to go into the Arizona fan like websites and just revel in all of their tears and comments. And it was, what a glorious, glorious feeling. And I was texting Christopher H. about this too. And he sent me a bunch of gifts and stuff that are absolutely hilarious that I probably should not share on the internet. Just a great day for redemption arcs, as you said. But let's pivot to the defense, right?
We're driven by the search for better. But when it comes to hiring, the best way to search for a candidate isn't to search at all. Don't search, match with Indeed. Indeed is your matching and hiring platform with over 350 million global monthly visitors, according to Indeed data, and a matching engine that helps you find quality candidates fast. Ditch the busy work. Use Indeed for scheduling, screening, and messaging so you can connect with candidates faster. Leveraging over 140 million qualifications and preferences every day, Indeed's matching engine is constantly learning from your preferences, so the more you use Indeed, the better it gets. Join more than 3.5 million businesses worldwide that use Indeed to hire great talent fast. And listeners of this show will get a $75 sponsored job credit to get your jobs more visibility at Indeed.com/BlueWire. Just go to Indeed.com/BlueWire right now and support our show by saying that you heard about Indeed on this podcast. That's Indeed.com/BlueWire. Terms and conditions apply. Need to hire? You need Indeed.
What did you think about their absolutely like turning on in the second half compared to how they were playing in the first half? The first half felt like just a hangover from Notre Dame, right? Like they were missing tackles, they had bad tracks, they had bad angles, they were filling the wrong gaps, they had way too much space in some of their zone coverages.
Yeah, everything was open over the middle. Everything.
Yeah, yeah, and then but the second half they just cleaned it right up.
Yeah, cleaned it right up. I don't know. I wish we got more insights into what the hell Wilcox said at halftime, but it was incredible. And I think he was right to call out Jed Fish and that team. Like, they came out, I think, and threw a bunch of looks that threw off the Cal defense a lot.
Yeah.
And consistently. And, you know, so it was partial credit to kind of Arizona's offense. And then basically our coaching staff is skilled enough from a defensive standpoint to basically be like, okay, this is like what we weren't expecting this at all. But if we adjust here and here, you know, we should figure it out. And I do agree. Like Patu's play was changed the entire game. That whole possession inside our territory that changed everything. I think there was like you know, the full start driven
back.
Yeah,
it went backwards. Yeah,
yeah, and then it ended started up going backwards, sack. And yeah. then the strip sack to complete it. So they went from, like, literal points on the board in the form of a field goal or maybe even a touchdown to, like, our possession. And it just sort of felt like that was a huge turning point in the game. And a turnover was going to matter a lot, too, because, I mean, in the same way, like, that Arizona defender almost got that pick on Plummer early. Like, if that yeah. is completed, we may be talking about a Cal loss. That just felt like a really big play in the game.
Yeah, so, three turnovers for the Bears on defense in the second half.
Yeah. I mean, we dominated. 28-7 second half. I mean, it was just like, that was like the Cal defense that we expected. There wasn't really much that Delora could do. We were bringing pressure. The secondary was holding their own. It was the only knock was, I think, the D-line was still struggling on its own to kind of get pressure, and they definitely had time. But it was, you know, Daniel Scott continues to do Daniel Scott things. Like, every game, I feel like he's had a key play so far. That dude is special, and it's just a blast to have him.
Once again, yeah, Daniel Scott definitely was great. Isaiah Young, like, Lou was absolutely stellar.
Herbie.
Lou went out early or late in the – was it late in the fourth or early in the fourth? Do you remember?
I think it was early in the fourth.
Yeah, and then Irby comes in. I mean, he had been playing all game, right? But he comes in as – and then plays the rest of the way and was absolutely stellar.
No. It was Isaiah that came in.
No, Isaiah was already playing as the other cornerback.
What?
Yeah.
Is Irby 41?
No, 41's young. Irby's 29.
Did they switch the side of the field that they were on?
They might have been.
Okay.
Yeah.
That makes sense. Yeah, Irby played really well. He had that pass breakup. Dude, Delora takes freaking shots, man. Like, yeah. That was so crazy. Like, he has no fear out there to just toss the ball up into the end zone and expect his receiver to come down with it. And they did. It was crazy. But Irby was the one on that play where they're going into the XX, you know, towards XX.
Yeah.
And they throw it up to the end zone. And, man, I don't think a lot of cornerbacks make that play. He went back on that ball perfectly, squared up, timed his leap perfectly, and you know, it was a bobble out of bounds, but it was just one of those pass breakups that was once again a huge difference maker, I think, in our confidence feeling, our stress levels towards the end of the game. But yeah, I mean, I think there's a lot of guys that you could kind of point to on the defense that played really well, obviously, in the second half to kind of do that against that offense is very, very impressive.
Yeah, I mean, Puskas, talk about a first start and then having that type of performance on the field too. Like, he didn't have that many stats, right? But that the sack was huge, absolutely hey. Huge. And you know, we asked him about it and he broke it down for us, and that was super cool to see. He's from Arizona too, so for his first start to be against Arizona, definitely a little bit more meaningful as well. So kudos. I mean, what more is there to say? This game was amazing. And, like, isn't it hilarious? Like, you look at the box score, and it's like the first touchdown of the game is Cal, number 6, Jaydn Ott, 73-yard rushing touchdown, 43 seconds. And the last is in the fourth quarter, 4:56, Cal, number 6, Jaydn Ott, 72-yard rush, 55 seconds.
Yeah. Man, when that guy gets to the second level,
he's gone.
He's gone. If there's daylight there, it's over. And that's super exciting. Exciting.
It was just so... like, you know how at the beginning of the season, right, I said, when you asked me about how good Ott was, and I told you, look, I think Ott is going to have those moments as Javid did his freshman year, right? Those moments of, oh, I think we know how good he could be. And we kind of saw it in the first and second week. But then this performance today, or this weekend, just puts him on a different level. Like, so I don't know if you saw, but I was watching Pac-12 After Dark, which is their, like, you know, wrap-up show on the Pac-12 network, and Shane Vereen was on. And they showed the Cal game, and he made a couple of comments. You know, he was like, it's a great day to be a Bear in the Pac-12, and
and so on. But they asked him about Ott, and Shane just dead eye looks at the camera and goes, "He's better than me." That's high praise coming from a guy who is a Pro Bowler and a Super Bowl champion.
Yes.
And he's telling you that he's better than you.
Big game MVP.
Yeah. A Super Bowl record holder, I believe, for receptions by a running back.
Yeah.
I
high praise.
High praise.
I mean, Jaden's so funny, too. He doesn't say anything in his press conference. I mean, the only thing he said was the line about taking his team out, and we forgot to ask the obvious question of where he's going to take out his O-line for dinner.
Is it Sizzler?
Yeah, I mean, that was the obvious follow-up, and we blew it. We blew it! But, I mean, he just doesn't say anything. And no. I think he's a very confident, but he strikes me on more of like a... doesn't seem overconfident. I mean, I remember being around some of the like superstar guys and even guys that weren't superstars that were overconfident. And Jaydn seems to strike a pretty good balance between young, but like very mature and just sort of being like, yeah, this was as much, you know, this was a team success. It wasn't just an individual success, but he's also just been so successful that he carries that confidence with him. It's that quiet confidence that kills, and he's got it because he's seen it before. I remember they asked, they're like, "Have you ever had this many yards before?" He's like, "Yeah."
Yeah, in high school.
In high school. Like, okay, next question.
Yeah, I don't know how else to explain it, but he definitely knows, like, you know, have you heard that story about, like, his dad when Jaydn was young and, like, what, I think Jaydn, it was Barry Sanders. Like, his dad gave him a tape of Barry Sanders, and that's all he kind of watched growing up. And that's, like, kind of a tribute to his, like, running style and why he does the high step. And that high step, actually, down the line, is going to get him away from a few shoelace tackles. Like, you will definitely see it, like, down the line when, you know, he's in the trenches and he just high steps it. And you just see a guy trying to grasp for his shoelace or his shoe or his ankle. And he's not going to be able to, like, just not be able to get it down. So, I don't know what else to say about this game. It was so much fun. Every single play was, I mean... There was a little bit of fear. I don't know about you, but there was a little bit of fear in me, like, oh my God, if this is a shootout, it's going to come down to like how much can our offense sustain this production? And I wasn't optimistic. I was not optimistic after like the second quarter. Like going into halftime, I was like, ah, dude, I don't know. I honestly don't know if we're going to be able to maintain this pace.
Yeah, there were some doubts. I mean, there's definitely some nerves even when it was like playing against a sunny team where even if they didn't score on a drive and they punted, they took like 30 seconds off the clock for the drive.
Yeah.
And they were just passing every play because their running game was just getting absolutely devoured in the second half. So it was just pass, pass, pass. And they would take zero time off the clock. And then we'd get the ball. And then like our two possessions, you know, it was just like we had an unfortunate penalty that set us back. And I think, you know, it just sort of left the game within close enough reach and they just weren't taking up any time. So there's definitely some moments in the fourth. I mean, we were up 11 and someone tweeted at me, this is terrible. I was like, we're up 11. What do you mean? And it's like, that's just the feeling of a Cal fan that hopefully we gets a race this year where it's like that feeling of impending doom when you're actually... Win, like up 11 and win the football game with like 10 minutes left. The odds are in such, are very much in your favor, but we just don't feel that as Cal fans.
Well, but it's also who we're playing against, right?
Like, yes,
that's true. That's but probably
if you listened to the preview from. Pod and you heard my prediction, you should have been fine. That's amazing. I don't get many of those right, but hot damn, I got the Arizona one right. That is great. Six picks, and I got that. I got one of them. I think that's like a first. I don't get many.
Honestly, I don't even remember what I talked about except for like some of the outrageous ones about sacks and stuff. So I'm actually going to have to go back and see what I said about the offense.
I have Sermon leading the tackles in the Pac-12. That's Jesse got his about upending the first to 21 rule,
which we did.
Mine was blowing out Arizona.
I just remember mine about sacks, but it also doesn't work because Britt Johnson went out injured and it just totally upended my stuff. But
you've had Wendy's nugs dipped in sauce, but have you had them covered in sauce? Wendy's new saucy nugs take the crispy and spicy nugs you love and turn them up to 11. Choose between flavors like buffalo or honey barbecue, garlic parm, or if you're a real heat seeker out there, you can try spicy ghost pepper only on Wendy's signature spicy nugs. Listen, I'm going to dare you to do it. I dare you. That's 7 delicious ways to try the nugs that you already love. Pick a flavor, grab some extra napkins, and then grab a few more napkins and prepare to nug like you've never nugged before. For a whole new way to nug, it's got to be Wendy's at participating U.S. Wendy's.
Oh, well. Oh. Time and a place, my friend. Yeah. At least you nailed it on the opponent's blog. That's the one that really matters. That's where to win. All right. Hit me with some fan questions, please.
Yes. So we got a bunch. So I've been asking fans for not just their questions, but takes, thoughts, whatever. We've actually been tweeted at quite a bit today just because a lot of stuff was happening and a lot of news dropping today with guys winning awards and so on. But let's start with, well, first, Andy, I don't know if you saw this, but I tweeted out on our California Golden Bearcast account that Matt Leinart put out his top 5 performers from week 4. And of course he did not include one Jaydn Ott. He did include Blake Corum from Michigan, who had 30 carries for 243 yards and 2 touchdowns, which by my count is more carries, but less yards and less touchdowns than Jaydn Ott. So I quote tweeted it by saying that Leinart is denying Jaydn Ott's performance like COVID and the vaccine. And our dear friend, Saman, tweeted at us saying, this is a good tweet. So we have the okay from an SC fan with tweeting that out.
Was Leinart anti?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's a great tweet.
Yeah.
Love that.
Yep. All right. But moving on, Gerardo, our dear friend Gerardo, tweets at us, I haven't been this excited for a postgame in a while. Ott's performance speaks for itself. Add in Plummer's ability to hit the end zone throws and the defense's ability to adjust after the half. Signs of growth. The 2-4-5 was unique to start, but glad the base D held them in check. That was actually really cool because there's actually Peter sent me in the Discord a little screenshot of one of our plays where we did not have a single defensive lineman in on the play. It was all linebackers and defensive backs. Pretty.
And Femi was playing on the line,
Yeah, it was. Let me see if I can pull it up real quick. But it was, I think, Femi on the outside. And then, where is it? Where are you? Let's see. Is it here? It might be here. Yeah. It's the Patu sack. So the Patu strip sack, it was Jernigan Puskas Oladejo Patu on the line.
Wow. I definitely didn't realize that at the time.
Yeah, and I think it's and then behind him at middle linebacker, I think it's the normal guys. I think it was Ruchina or Pastor and Jackson Sermon. So we went with a speed rush on that play, which is pretty cool.
Yeah, and it worked.
Yeah, so Peter did a breakdown of it. It says Puskas drops into a QB spy. Jernigan gets doubled. Oladejo takes out the left guard. This wasted the center and had Oladejo and Patu one-on-one. And Patu, of course, beats that one-on-one and gets to him at the end. Pretty cool.
Yeah.
Pretty cool. But Gerardo asks, also super impressed, or comments in us, also super impressed by the shuffled O-line performing so well. My sole question coming out of this is, when do you think we figure out what that base defense looks like? There was a lot of shuffling this week. Players hurt, new starters. Go Bears.
What do you think?
I think we've seen the base D. I think the base D is, it's one of two, right? If we're playing a pass heavy team, it'll be nickel with Gamble in at the nickel, but normal, it's going to be that 4-3 look, with like the defensive end slash outside linebacker, edge guy, or an extra one. So we'll have Ricky, playing inside, probably with Jaydn Roberts and Xavier or Odua, if Odua is ready to go by this week, on the other. And then you have Sermon, Oladejo, Jernigan, and Croto, or whoever else you want to, whoever you want to plug in to play there. I think you could argue Oren Patu played a pretty good game, and he's probably going to get a few more snaps now. I think the light's starting to turn on for a few of these guys, where they're going to be a part of the rotation moving forward.
And we rotate a lot of guys in regardless of injury.
I mean, they try to.
Yeah, we've seen that over the years, including last year, where we were just shuffling a ton of guys in and out.
Yeah.
That ultimately benefits everyone because they get that experience. So the rotation that we're seeing does not concern me. And I just think defensively, we have a lot of depth. We have a lot of depth. And especially in the secondary. Secondary just seems like it's just such a well-oiled machine at this point.
Yeah.
It's wild to say. It's been like 6 years of just incredible play in the secondary.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Super impressive.
We got another question from Cal, our dear friend Cal Kangila on Twitter. I keep butchering your name, man. I'm so sorry. Every time you tweet at us. What are the biggest keys to beating Washington State?
Well, let's see. I immediately would say you have to the success of the Cal team this season, I think, is unbelievably predictable. You have to be able to put pressure on the opposing quarterback, and you have to be able to protect your own. That's it. Like, that's the way I see it. Because fundamentally, what Rob and Jesse saw at practice was because the line was holding up. And then what you actually saw against UNLV and against Notre Dame was the line wasn't holding up, so the offense kind of withered away. So fundamentally, to me, like, it's very simple for Cal this year. We either win in the trenches and we win the game, or we lose in the trenches and we play a tight, nerve-wracking game. It's not a guaranteed loss, but it's a guaranteed win if you win that battle. That's what I'm going to say. That this year, if we protect a quarterback, if we create holes for, you know, our running backs to go through them, the formula is somewhat simple. We will win those football games. I'd be shocked if we lost that game, unless it was maybe against like an SC.
Yeah, I think you're right.
So then that's like irrespective of Washington State. And I'd love, Rob, to get your thoughts on Washington State specifically.
I think on Washington State specifically, I was doing a little bit of my research yesterday and today, and I was focused in on what you were talking about, right? So I was looking across their defensive line, their measurables. Their measurables are pretty similar. There's no one really outstanding. Just from like a height and weight perspective on their defensive line, it looks very similar to Arizona's. Although a few people have noted to me that Washington State's defensive line is probably faster and more athletic. So once again, that'll boil, and then that just funnels into offensive line play, right? Like, if you can continue to get the push that you're getting now and the holes that you're making, it doesn't matter how fast the other guys are. Because if you're getting that hole for Jaydn, he's gone. So coming out and playing that game out of the gate is going to be huge, and consistently playing. Because look, if we're all assuming that this offensive line that we watched on Saturday is going to be the same offensive line, like in terms of who's playing on the line, it's going to be the same group of five guys that starts at Washington State. And if they're getting demolished in the first and second quarter, you're going to have to make changes again. And that's kind of what we don't want, right? You don't want to consistently be making changes with the offensive line. I think this is the offensive line they're going to try and run with. And if it does work again, and to the success that it does against a very good defensive Washington State team, that feels wrong to say, by the way, to say Washington State's a really good defensive first team.
Yeah, come again.
Yeah. Yeah, I need to get some mouthwash. But so if they can do that, then that pretty much is the key to the game that Andy was saying too. Like this team is offensively, at least, is predicated on the offensive line performing well, because everything else happens behind there, whether it's the run game getting the burst through or it's the play action game from that run game that gets us some big chunk plays, or if it's, for crying out loud, we saw five wide receiver sets this week. If it's five wide receiver sets and we're getting to spread and move the ball by, you know, getting pass pro for Jack to be able to develop some of the route concepts happening down the field, once again, all starts with the offensive line. So this was huge for them to be able to play like they did against Arizona, against another Power 5 team. Now, can they continue the confidence and that same level of play? Even if it dips a little bit, it's fine. They played absolutely outstanding this week. So we're going to see, I don't want to say regression, but I do see, because we're playing a better defensive team, I do think that there's going to be a little bit of a drop-off.
It will definitely regress from 600 yards of offense and 274 yards for maybe, I shouldn't say definitely, but odds are likely that we're going to regress a little bit.
Yep.
But I agree with you. Continuity on the O-line is what we're looking for. That's the name of the game there. We can shuffle as many people as we want defensively.
Andy, my brother, if we drop another 600 yards of offense on the Washington State team, I am driving to Vegas to put money down on us winning the conference.
Wow. You're going to drive there?
I don't care what it is. Like, to do that back-to-back weeks...
Southwest, my friend. Southwest.
Unheard of. Unheard of.
Yes, it would be incredible. All of a sudden, yes. Wait and see. Wait and see.
It's a wait and see. Joe Kenyon tweets at us, thank God we get a second year break from the filth and wizardry that is the U of A games. My question is, as Oth continues on this path, might he become the greatest Cal back of all time? Ooh, that's a fun question. After one game of 200 plus yards.
Well, also his game against UC Davis, like
100 yards in his first start. Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, yeah, if he continues at this pace, depends on how long he stays. Depends on how long he stays.
I mean, he's staying here for a minimum of 3 years.
We hope. Yes.
Well, he has to.
Doesn't have to.
Yeah, I mean, I doubt he's leaving. I don't get why everyone's pushing this theory that he might leave us for another.
Doesn't have to.
It's not going to happen.
Yeah, so you're saying over a three-year period.
Yeah.
I understand that.
It's
totally possible. I just hate to project any of that on, because it's like, it's still too early, and health plays a big factor in all of this as well, especially getting hit as much as you do as a running back. So just hope for good health, and let's keep it at that for now.
My guy Joe, if he continues at this pace, and let's say he gets like another, like what, like 150 yards or 170 yards against Washington State, and then goes to Colorado and does the same thing with like another like 200 yards.
Yeah.
The athletics department is probably getting ready for a Heisman campaign.
Rob is going to drive to Vegas again.
Yeah. Again.
He's just going to be driving to Vegas and doing podcasts in the car.
Yeah.
On his way to Vegas.
No. We're gonna be doing podcasts on the drive to Vegas.
I will be flying on Southwest. Thank you very much.
Yeah, I think if he continues on this pace, it beyond the down the road stuff, it's like this year the implications of what he could do changes everything. Like, he leads the conference in yards by 70 yards. That's like that. That was the high for some of our running backs last season in a game. So we're like a full game ahead of some of these guys.
Yeah. Good point. Love that point.
So, like, if he continues on this pace, look, he's at 463 yards and we're through four games, right? So multiply that by three. We'll have close to a 1,300 or 1,400-yard running back by the end of the season with as many, you know, however many touchdowns he gets rushing and via passing. That's a Heisman campaign.
Yeah.
We
need to chill. But you are correct. I think if you extrapolate the numbers that he has accumulated so far across an entire season.
Yeah, if you do like the per season stuff.
I think he'd be number one.
Yeah.
I think he'd be, and then he did that for the next 2 years. I think he'd be number one.
Yep.
Yeah.
That's all we're saying.
That is how rare and how special the start of this season has been for him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely. All right, got a couple other ones. Paul Jones tweets at us. I was pretty harsh towards Musgrave last week, but I am definitely pleased, with what I saw on Saturday. If that offensive production becomes the norm, what is a realistic ceiling for Cal's win total this season? Well, that's actually a good one for Andy.
Nine.
What was your ceiling before? Wasn't it nine?
Nine. Yeah.
You think it still stays at nine with this offensive production?
Well, look, I think I was. One of the best precursors for a good Musgrave performance is me droning on the podcast about how frustrated I am about the offense. So last week was perfect. I think that the ceiling for this team, if the offense starts to open up, like I don't even think it has to be this impressive of a showing. It just has to be an offense that can average 30 to 35 points a game. It's like you're looking at like a 9-3 season. You know, I'm assuming you're still going to lose one of the games. I think you still lose against SC. And then I still think UCLA has our number. I know people think I'm crazy for that. But until I'm proven otherwise, history is on my side. So, yeah, I mean, I really do think it's like 9 wins if you can average like 30 to 35 a game. Doesn't have to be. And then if you get into the 40-plus range, like, yeah, I think your ceiling goes up to, like, 10 or 11. There's no reason why. I mean, SC is the only one I look on this schedule and say that's probably a loss.
I don't know. Right? As of right now, Washington looks like the more of the loss than SC.
Yeah, Washington looks good. But we play Washington super well, always have. We have the history on our side there. Well, and we get them at home. SC's on the road.
It's a different coaching staff.
Yeah, that's fine. I just think, like, I don't know. Some of that's real, dude. How many different coaches did Arizona have in the time that they played us, and yet they had their run? You know, it's like three. Some of those times you just like have that confidence because you just have that confidence, and you're like, you know, like Washington's been a toss up for the last 5-6 years, whereas like SC has not, and then SC has Lincoln Riley. So, but yeah, like to get to the main point, like I agree. Like the Musgrave offense is super interesting because people were talking about like now you're seeing like the most dynamic offense and like what made the Raiders amazing. And it's like, on the one hand, I want to buy into that. And I want to be like, yes, that's awesome. And like, this is the true potential of like what we've been trying to do. On the flip side, you can still be frustrated about what you've seen before.
Yeah.
And I don't think I've lost any of that frustration of like this. It's about adapting to what is happening, and I think you can make a pretty strong case that we adapt really slowly to game scenarios, what's happening, what defenses are showing you. So you'd have to see a fundamental shift there where we continually are better at adapting to the scenarios that are thrown our way. And if we do that, there isn't any reason why in a Pac-12 conference that is no longer based on on North and South, why Cal couldn't end up in that 2 spot and all of a sudden we could all be going to Vegas. Rob will already be there, of course.
Yeah. Yeah, because and I keep getting my predictions right. So Vegas will favor itself.
He keeps driving. So I don't know. But Rob, I'd love to hear your thoughts there.
I I think if the offense performs, keeps performing like this, I think the ceiling becomes 10 wins. And I don't think that's like irrational. You got to like kind of put some like rules and restrictions down. Like if he's saying the offensive production becomes the norm, like we score, us scoring 40 plus becomes the norm.
Yeah.
Then yeah, absolutely. 10 wins becomes a viable possibility, yeah. Especially with the way that the defense adapted in the second half and totally shut down Arizona. So if they're able to do that, yeah, why not? If you're averaging 40 plus points a game on offense and you're averaging 24 points or less on defense, usually means that there's a bigger... This is the thing that Nam has always been arguing for, is the margin of error to a victory has increased significantly. And yes, that is what you want to be increasing. And if that happens... Of course you're not going to be, you know, sitting there hoping that a 50-50 ball goes your way for you to win, because you would have already won the game handedly before that.
By the way, Notre Dame beat UNC.
Oh, did you also? Oh,
45-32.
Speaking of Notre Dame, oh, good thing you brought that up. There's a couple more tweets and messages, but I did want to bring this up. Roxy, our dear friend Roxy Bernstein, tweeted this out today. That he tweeted out earlier saying that the ref who called the phantom offsides call, right, would be suspended.
Yes.
He tweeted out this morning, just received information from ACC that linesman Matthew Fitzgerald did in fact work a game this past weekend, crewed by the conference. He was not with his regular crew, which officiated Georgia Tech at USF. Followed up the tweet with, instead, he was part of a crew that was assigned to the Notre Dame at North Carolina game. He worked a Fighting Irish game for the second consecutive week.
What kind of buffoonery is this? Wow. That is a level of ineptitude that is usually reserved for the Pac-12.
Because we saw Roxy's tweet before, right?
Yeah, 100%. Like full about, suspension. Like I was for sure.
Yeah, he was saying that they were gonna suspend him for a game, and he wasn't gonna play anything. Let me see if I can find that tweet on Roxy's Twitter here real quick. Yeah, linesman Matt Fisher was the official that was suspended. And his crew that worked that North Carolina Cal game was actually at the Georgia Tech and Central Florida game, except for Fitzgerald. But then he was sent to the UNC Florida game, or UNC UNC Notre Dame game. So Roxy actually tweeted this on the 24th, saying, according to sources, ACC has suspended side judge from the game who called Cal for being offsides on this play. ACC apologized to Cal for the error and admitted it was a bad call. As of now, they don't plan on making public acknowledgement of error and punishment. So his punishment was being sent from not his normal group of officiating buddies, but to another one, but still officiating a game with the same Fighting Irish team.
I look forward to watching the 30 for 30 in 15 years about how this dude was being paid by the Archdiocese.
It's hilarious. At this point, it's like less about like being a Cal fan and being upset at that ref, but like if you know, and if you're a team that's playing Notre Dame and you know this about that ref, I don't get why you're not upset of that ref being at that game. Like, I mean, you have to be upset, right?
Dude, 100%. 100%.
Yeah.
If I'm a UNC fan, I am like,
you're not happy.
Yeah. Not happy.
I'm gonna look into seeing if there were any controversial calls for the UNC Notre Dame game later. But anyways, we got some other ones, so, and we're recording pretty long today, so I want to get through all these questions for everyone. Ryan Foster's plea to Cal's OC to run the ball on Twitter. Do we have any insight into why Brooks has been the clear number two back behind Ott? Is Moore hurt or had his role reduced? We don't have any official stuff. I will say DeCarlos was going to be the number two back, in my opinion, no matter what, because Chris Street would have been the power back. But Chris Street is currently out injured, and I think they said they would expect him back this season sooner rather than later. So who knows? Maybe it's after the bye week or maybe this week. But he was supposed to be the power back. Since he went down, DeCarlos plays that power back role. They have a bunch of plays for the whoever is running in the power back role. And Ott has definitely become number one. So you can't shift more into the power back role because that's not his style of running, nor is it his play. So that's why Moore ends up being, you know, a bit of a backseat and basically the third running back on the roster. That's my take on it.
Yeah, I mean, Damian's playing well. Like, I'm not worried about it right now.
Yeah. We talked about the running backs. It's a long season.
Yeah, it's a long.
You're going to need
exactly,
everyone.
Exactly. Exactly. Well said.
Of course, our dear friend Sid messages us. Jaydn Ott, that's a tweet. I really hope that this is only a glimpse of what our offense can do. Has your impression of Bill Musgrave changed from this game? If so, how? Or has it stayed the same, or do you need more games to be played?
This is why we need to always ask Sid's questions first, because she asks really good questions, and then we end up answering them.
Yeah.
But first of all, number one, Sid, why are you not at the Right for Cal tailgates?
She's busy.
That's a mystery. Apparently, too busy for us. Number two, more importantly, I mean, I think we did just kind of touch on this, but like, yeah, there is an element of like, wow, like that was, you can see what happens. Like, let's say big game last year.
Yeah.
I think like big game last year was like very similar to this game.
Yeah.
Like kind of a tight first half. And then we just blew it out of the water in the second half.
Well, we also waited for Stanford to make that comeback at some point on offense, right? Just kind of how we felt Arizona was going to, but our defense just clamped down.
Yeah, exactly. And so I feel like this offense just has those moments where you see the full potential of it. It's just about getting it in a consistent way. And so I think like this game was fantastic in seeing its potential, and now we just need to realize it every game here on out. And it doesn't have to be 49 points, but like I want to see like a 35-point game. I want to see a 32-point game. And if you start to get that rather than the 17s and the 21s and 20s, then I think, yeah, your opinion starts to change. If it just goes right back and let's say even when we beat Washington State, but we win 17-13, I'm right back to where I am. Because like a flash in the pan is not something that I'm going to bet on consistently.
Yeah.
And I want something that I can take home and accurately like count on to show up week over week.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of the feeling after when we beat Oregon State in 2018, right? Or it's the last time we scored 49 points under Wilcox. It was like, oh, wow, this offense can actually really go. Will this be the turnaround point for the offense? And ESPN 30 for 30 narrating voice comes in and says, it was not.
It was not.
So, I mean, my take on Sid's question, has your impression of Bill Musgrave changed from this game in terms of the offense? Not really, because me and Jesse, I think I could speak for him, has been one of the, we trust what we saw at fall camp, and we trust that it'll come good at a certain point. And it just, as we talked about multiple times on this pod, this is my victory tour pod. It feels great to be vindicated.
Yes, it does. Well deserved.
Oh, it feels so good. Yeah. If any of you have some, tweets that you wrote about my prediction and whatnot, and you want to get it signed, just print it and bring it to the tailgate. I'll be happy to sign it for you. Andy, you're one of your friends. Shavit Karen tweets at us. He says, impressed by the way the reconfigured offensive line played. Hopefully they can keep it up against defenses with a pulse.
Yeah, valid. There's a little bit of skepticism in that. I like that.
Yeah.
That's what we need. We're getting a little high. And look at what happened to Arizona. They were so high after beating North Dakota State. They're just like, I loved it when they're all those comments. They're just so much optimism, and that's the beautiful thing about college football. And then it can just come crashing down in one game.
Yeah, then everyone. I loved some of the guys saying, like, they're admitting I might have drank too much Kool-Aid.
Yeah,
I love it.
It happens to us right now. This podcast can be an example of that. I hope that it isn't, but it's pretty easy to get excited and then just come crashing back down to reality. So skepticism is well deserved. But I think that even if you had the O-line play be 50% as effective as it was against Arizona, that Cal's probably coming away being in a pretty good spot in that football game.
Yeah.
So it's just doesn't take that level of dominance to be able to do some of the things that we were doing. And hopefully we continue to leverage the tight ends more. I think I still am really eager to see how we're going to take advantage of Jermaine Terry. I am so surprised we can't find ways to get him the ball. Even if like you had like a crazy play, like where you had a designed run for him, he's so big. No one can tackle him. I don't know. I think like in a short down, a short position, you know, like the way that the Chiefs leverage Kelce.
Yeah.
It'd be pretty interesting to see a couple like shovel passes or something like that. Or where like he's in motion coming in and they get him the ball like to get a couple yards like that dude. I just think we can feature him more in the offense and become even that much more dynamic. So excited to see what happens on Saturday.
Very excited. Once again, Cal takes on Washington State at 2:30 p.m. on Pac-12 Network.
Oh, dude, we didn't even talk about 2:30. Quick side note.
Sure.
2:30, you were spot on. Wasn't that what you're saying? 2:30 is perfect. Yeah, 2:30 is perfect. End of argument. 2:30 kickoff, absolutely perfect.
Well, 2:30 kickoffs are my second favorite. My first favorite is 4 p.m.
Ah, fine.
Yeah.
There is no pleasing you. I was trying to give you a compliment here.
You should go back and listen. I've perennially said and stayed constant with all of it. 4 p.m. kickoffs are my favorite because you get both the day game look for half the game, and then you get the night game look for the second half.
Hmm. Interesting.
And gives you enough time to tailgate.
Lots of time. That's why I like the 2:30. 2:30 was legendary.
Yeah, 2:30 is good, but it also means you have to like wake up early, and it's like, do you eat breakfast? Do you not eat breakfast? And like Rico with sometimes his tailgate food is like, do we do breakfast? Because people start coming in at like 10, 10:30. Or do we just do lunch food? There's just a lot of question marks with a 2:30. But with a 4, it's like, yeah, well, it's always just solid lunch, done. And we move on. So that's it. We sigh, but it's good size. It's size of relief. It feels like me when I realized we were scoring 40 points and I just leaned back in the chair inside the press box and just soaked it in. I just looked at Jesse and I was just like, you should soak in the moment.
Yeah. There's like a deep residing peace in your soul as Rob leaned back in his press box chair, took a quick gander over the field in the stadium and let out a huge sigh. It was like, it was not smugness, but it was a smug like feeling in the best of ways.
It's the gif of, Captain Holt from Brooklyn Nine-Nine. Vindication!
Yes. Yeah, exactly. What a good show. I love that show.
That's such a great show. But that wraps it up for us here on the Golden Bearcast. You can find all our written stuff at writeforcalifornia.com. You can find us on Twitter at Golden Bearcast. And anything else you need, of course, check the site. There's so much good material going up every single day, every week. There's a Pick'ems League. There's the watch-alongs. There's all the play breakdowns, all the numbers, Christopher H's stellar previews that get flack from opposing teams. So you know as a Cal fan you're going to enjoy it. That's where you can also find this podcast if that's where you're listening from. But if not, you can find all of our social media links on our Twitter page, in the bio, on our link tree. That's where you'll find all of the sites and places and podcast services around the world that you can listen to the California Golden Bearcast. And Andy, with that, as always, go Bears.
Go Bears.
We're driven by the search for better. But when it comes to hiring, the best way to search for a candidate isn't to search at all. Don't search, match with Indeed. Indeed is your matching and hiring platform with over 350 million global monthly visitors, according to Indeed data, and a matching engine that helps you find quality candidates fast. Ditch the busy work. Use Indeed for scheduling, screening, and messaging so you can connect with candidates faster. Leveraging over 140 million qualifications and preferences every day, Indeed's matching engine is constantly learning from your preferences. So the more you use Indeed, the better it gets. Join more than 3.5 million businesses worldwide that use Indeed to hire great talent fast. And listeners of this show will get a $75 sponsored job credit to get your jobs more visibility at Indeed.com/BlueWire. Just go to Indeed.com/BlueWire right now and support our show by saying that you heard about Indeed on this podcast. That's Indeed.com/BlueWire. Terms and conditions apply. Need to hire? You need Indeed.